And I am so pleased tonight to welcome you to the F. Joseph Callahan Distinguished Lecture featuring Professor Henry Louis Gates, Jr. Tonight's program is the third lecture in the 2016-2017 Think Forum Lecture Series. We've had some remarkable guests this year, Susan Laurie Parks, Tony Kushner, and Sarah Vowell. We'll close the season this year with Jay Famietti next month, and I hope many of you can join us talking about water, very important for the Great Lakes. I want to begin by acknowledging Tim Callahan, Vice Chair of Case Western Reserve's Board of Trustees, and his wife, Nancy Callahan, both graduates of Case Western Reserve, I'm proud to tell you, both trustees of the Callahan Foundation, which provided the leadership gift to support this treasured and thought-provoking lecture series. Tim is the son of the late Francis Joseph Callahan, Jr., a scholar, retired Navy officer, Chairman Emeritus of Swagelok, philanthropist, and the person whom we honor and remember through this lecture in his name. Joe Callahan, or Joe as he was known, and his wife Mary Elizabeth, founded the Callahan Foundation in 1968, and it has awarded more than $16.5 million in grants to worthy causes in higher education, the arts, and social services. Tim and Nancy, thank you so much for your generous support, for your outstanding leadership at Case Western Reserve, and for all you do for our community. Please stand up. Come on. I now direct your attention to the screen so that you can learn more about Francis Joseph Callahan, Jr.
Joe Callahan came from simple beginnings. He grew up in Lima, Ohio. But fundamentally, my father was a competitor. He believed that you should try to achieve a very high level of excellence in what you do. After he graduated from the United States Naval Academy, the Navy sent him to MIT twice. Once for a degree in electrical engineering, and once for a master's degree in nuclear engineering. Joe Callahan was a project officer on the world's first nuclear submarine, the Nautilus. He was responsible for the design and building of the nuclear systems on the submarines. He felt his training in the Navy was the most substantive time of his life. Submarines, by their nature, are run by small groups of people. The people had to get along very well with one another. And so he took a lot of the aspects of training from the Navy and applied those to business management. And Swagelok originally kept its manufacturing plants quite small. And the idea behind that was that the managers would know the employees. He very much liked to be a member of the team. He felt that he was very fortunate in his life. He worked hard, but he's had a lot of great breaks, and he did exactly what he wanted to do. What a great life. Joe Callahan believed that if you've been fortunate, that you have a duty to help other people. The Callahan Foundation was founded to support areas of excellence in Cleveland, and those include education, the arts, and healthcare. I think the Distinguished Lecture Series is a great way to celebrate Joe Callahan's life.
Somewhere in this room tonight, you will find the chair of our Board of Trustees, and I'm going to ask him to stand up, Jim Wyant. Jim, where are you? Thank you. And we have Trustee Ginny Barbato. Ginny, where are you? Somewhere? Ah, thank you. Emeriti trustees, Lainey Haddon and David Hunt, where are you? Cuyahoga County Executive Armin Budish and Amy Budish. And our very special guests, the Reverend Otis Moss Jr. and Edwina. A theologian, pastor, civic leader, one of our nation's most prominent civil rights leaders, Reverend Moss served as pastor of Olivet Institutional Baptist Church for 33 years. I've only been at Case Western Reserve for 10, so I don't think I'm going to make it for 33. We are so delighted that you are here this evening because you are going to hear from a legendary scholar of African and African American studies, Dr. Henry Louis Gates, Jr., on the fascinating topic of ancestry as it relates to immigration. While an internationally prominent intellectual, Professor Gates also brings his exceptional expertise to wider audiences through his award-winning television program and numerous documentaries, as well as through his articles in popular newspapers and magazines. I know you all are looking forward to what is going to be an enriching, informative, and insightful lecture on a topic of tremendous interest. This evening, we are fortunate to have one of Case Western Reserve's most esteemed faculty members, Professor Peter Knox, who holds the Eric and Jane Nord Family Professorship and is also the director of the Baker Nord Center for the Humanities, a renowned classicist, to introduce Professor Gates and to moderate our question and answer session. Tonight's lecture also serves as the keynote address of the second annual Cleveland Humanities Festival, which is the brainchild of Professor Knox. It brings together Cleveland's numerous cultural and educational institutions to address meaningful issues in new and challenging ways, and this year's focus could not be more timely on immigration. When describing the festival, Professor Knox said, "The humanities help us understand who we are, what we've done and created along the way." He also recognized that while immigration is right now a politically charged topic, the festival's goal is to provide a mechanism to think more deeply about the significant role of immigration in shaping our communities. When not coordinating a major festival, Professor Knox is unwavering in his efforts to highlight and celebrate the arts and humanities here at Case Western Reserve. We are so grateful to him for his leadership, to the Baker Nord Center for the Humanities, for providing a rich and welcoming community for our students interested in the classics, in literature, in history, in philosophy, music, theater, and art history, among other disciplines. In fact, many of our science and engineering majors pursue a minor or a second major in fields in the humanities or social sciences. These students know, as Professor Knox knows, that the humanities are a means to better understand the world in which we live. In a recent article in Cleveland Scene magazine about this year's Humanities Festival, Professor Knox noted why it is so important for all of us to embrace the humanities by saying, "I think we're seeing an impoverishment of public discourse, an absence of historical perspective, a failure of empathy on the part of one person to another. These are some of the virtues and skills that you learn in the humanities. When you apply those things to problems of common interest, we all learn from it." Both Professors Knox and Gates have devoted their careers to enhancing scholarship and understanding of the humanities so that we better appreciate both our history and current events. I can think of no one better to introduce tonight's speaker than Professor Peter Knox.
Thank you, President Snyder. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I want to welcome you to the opening event in the Baker Nord Center's calendar of events for the second annual Cleveland Humanities Festival. We are particularly delighted to be partnering with Think Forum to include the F. Joseph Callahan Distinguished Lecture as the keynote address in this year's festival. The Cleveland Humanities Festival is a collaborative event coordinated by the Baker Nord Center for the Humanities. And every spring now, we celebrate the great educational and cultural institutions of this city and Northeast Ohio that provide a platform to explore from the perspective of the humanities subjects that matter to us as a society and as a nation. This year, we have more than 25 partner institutions offering programs on the theme of immigration. Large institutions, including many of our great museums, colleges, and public libraries, as well as many smaller organizations in our communities. It is thrilling to see so many of you here tonight, and I hope that you will take the opportunity to attend many other events in the festival, most of which are free and open to the public. We have defined 2017's theme of immigration very broadly to cover the movements of people that shape our changing communities. It can mean immigrants relocating to settle in new lands, but it can also mean exiles driven from their homes, refugees seeking safety and shelter, or whole groups of people deported for profit or out of hatred. 18 months ago, when we began planning for this event, we knew that the subject would be important because it always has been. What we did not know then is how urgent it would be today in this, our nation of immigrants, to think deeply and seriously about who we are as a people and where we came from. Because if we are honest, we all have to acknowledge that we all came from someplace, but it certainly wasn't this place. And who better to remind us of the rich and diverse fabric from which our nation is woven than our distinguished guest this evening, Dr. Henry Louis Gates, Jr. Now, an introduction for Dr. Gates can only be either very short or very long. And since we only have about 70 minutes this evening, I will aim for the shorter versions. That means that I will not talk about all the books and articles he has written, all the awards he has won, all the films he has authored, produced, or appeared in. I won't mention that he is the Alphonse Fletcher University Professor at Harvard and director of that university's Hutchins Center for African and African American Research. I won't say anything about his contributions as a literary critic, which have meant so much to those of us who have made literature our business. Nor will I mention how well known he is here in Cleveland from his long association with the Anisfield Wolf Awards. And I certainly will not bring up his stunning new PBS series, Africa's Great Civilizations. Because this evening, he's here to speak to us on the subject of ancestry, a topic that he has investigated in several formats, most recently in his series, Finding Your Roots. In tracing the genetic footprints of prominent Americans, Dr. Gates has been offering us all a lesson about the ties that connect us as human beings. We need that lesson perhaps more than ever now in the midst of a national conversation about slamming shut the door to immigrants and closing our gates to refugees. So please join me in welcoming to Cleveland and to CWRU our F. Joseph Callahan Distinguished Lecturer, Henry Louis Gates, Jr.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks so much. This is an amazing place. I can't imagine where the people worshipped in this synagogue went to. It couldn't have been better, more glorious than this. And it looks Sephardic. You know, I just made a film about Africa, which I hope some of you have, were able to see. And one of the things I wanted to stress was the role of Islam in Africa, and of course the role of Islam in the history of the West through the occupation, or whatever I'm supposed to say. What if you run a land, a country for 700 years, is that an occupation? But of course we know the Moors who ran the Iberian Peninsula until 1492 from 711. And I wanted to do that precisely because the diversity of America is under attack, unfortunately. And all of us who love America and who love the principles upon which this great country has, was founded, have to stand up for the diversity represented by this marvelous architecture. Thank you. But thank you, Peter, for that great introduction. I loved all the things about me that you did not say. And thank you, President Snyder, for hosting my return to Case Western. This has been a magical place for me for a long time, and I'll tell you why in a minute. But before that, please give it up for the Right Reverend Otis Moss, Jr. himself. Where is he? Where's Otis? Oh, and Edwina. That's my man. Make way for the Lord. Make way for the Lord. Otis Moss III sent me an email a couple days ago saying, Dr. Gates, my daddy and mama can't get a ticket to see you. It's all. I knew it was a joke. You know, I knew he wanted to see how many nanoseconds it would take for me to respond and say, of course, your father is going to get, and your mother going to get tickets. I summer on Martha's Vineyard, and every summer at the Union Chapel, they invite the greatest preachers in America. And for the last 2 years, they've invited Otis Moss Jr. and Otis Moss III to do a father and son routine. It is bad, man, I'm telling you. It is. It's like having, Frederick Douglass and Martin Luther King doing back and forth. But it's really quite wonderful. It's great to see you, my friend. I said that it's an honor to be back here because this place has a mystical kind of power for me. I'm looking for, oh, here it is, looking for water. Why? Because Frederick Douglass himself gave the first commencement address that a black person ever gave in this country, and he did at Western Reserve in 1854. Isn't that amazing? And every year I teach his speech. It was called The Claims of the Negro Ethnologically Considered. I have a big lecture course that I co-teach with Larry Bobo, the sociologist. And all the students in our class, we have 180 students this semester, I think, they all have to read that commencement address that Douglass gave. And it's it's a defense of the very humanity of the person of African descent. And that sounds like a metaphor when we talk about it today. We're not talking about whether the person was of equal stature as a citizen. We're talking about whether Africans were members of the human community. Whether the African was closer in relation to Europeans and other human beings, the other varieties of man, as it was commonly put in the middle of the 19th century, or to the apes. That sounds so hyperbolic to us today, but those were the stakes. And that's what the case that Frederick Douglass made at the 1854 commencement at Reserve. So it's fascinating for me to be here and to think about that and to think about what all the anxiety Frederick Douglass must have felt. Because he had to not only make an intellectual argument for people of African descent, he had to embody people of African descent. And we all know from our subject positions, whether you're a Jewish person, whether you're female, whether you're gay, lesbian, whether you are black, whatever your subject position, we all understand and appreciate that kind of pressure, that kind of responsibility. And Douglass, above all, stood up for immigration, the magic of immigration in producing the wonder of the United States. You might think of it as the migration of human diversity from all around the world to this great country. And that defense of immigration, that concept of migration of human beings and of genes, is what my PBS series, Finding Your Roots, is really all about. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. Could we show a video clip, please?
Are we good?
I'm a little nervous, I will say. You ready?
Yeah, good.
Where do you think those dark stories come from, Stephen?
Dr. Gates, I could tell you, but I'd have to kill you.
The suspense is killing me.
Written in these walls are the stories that I can't explain.
My man, we are just getting started.
I leave my heart open, but it stays right here empty for days.
I'm up for surprises.
At his funeral, there were like 100 people who were probably
The man wanted us kids because he worked with the circus and wanted us to be trapeze artists. No way.
Skip, I wanted you to see this picture. This is my grandmother.
Oh, wow. You said you grew up on a farm.
I used to love picking Uncle Jim's tomatoes and putting salt on them.
Even. That's all you
need. Right there.
Oh, no, a Tory.
He was not down with George Washington.
This is the thing I'm most ashamed of. I am humiliated by this part, right? Because I bleed red, white, and blue. Mm-hmm. And this is not the Union Jack. And this is terrible. this is so cruel. I mean, this is the way this works, right? You tease with a doctor here and a lawyer there, and then all of a sudden you've got a slave owner. And then you've got a Tory.
Genealogy giveth, genealogy taketh away.
The Book of Life of Anthony Robert Kushner.
Oh my God. Can I skip to the last page and see how I die?
You cannot.
How would anybody find all of this? Well, can't believe these documents even exist.
This is a total revelation to me.
This is a service record of your great-great-grandfather. In fact, your family, like a one-family Confederate army.
Great.
No way! We're related?
You ever hear these names?
Almond Bruce French is an awesome name, and I wish I knew before Hassan, because that would have been his name. Let's go, Almond Bruce.
You want to find out who
yeah.
wrote it? Turn the page.
What? Come on.
Your father's family was Jewish.
See? I knew it.
I grew up with stories, mostly untold. Because they were embarrassed and ashamed to talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
It really was a generational silence, but we knew, we knew.
This is so cool, man.
And this is where we've edited the films for the last 20 years.
Yes, sir.
You see where that punk is?
My mother died when I was 11. I think the reclaiming of the loss made me an amateur historian.
You'd be proud of me, buddy.
I hope so.
This is the face my ancestors looked at every day.
The man they feared, the man they had to please.
Now I'm looking into their world.
Your father stepped up to the opportunity. I mean, he seized the moment. Glad we could show you that document.
Thank you.
It's very precious.
George Washington was president
Still
of the United
president.
States when your third great-grandfather was born.
That's ridiculous.
Your ancestor was accused of being a spy and a traitor. Look at all these ancestors. You could cook dinner for one person. Who would it be?
That's a great question.
And this shows us that there's still a living aspect to history, like a personal connection.
Yeah. The story of my
life. Isn't that what you want? Just to be remembered in some way?
Mm-hmm.
300 years after you die, I'll take it. You know, I'll take that.
You gotta know where you're from.
That's crazy.
I mean, I feel like I belong to something bigger than me.
I feel a renewed interest and pride in this side of the family because mm-hmm. I've never known any of this.
It's part of my DNA, my history, and somehow who I am is very related to who these people were. So I feel connected to them.
It makes me feel very lucky.
You see that there's a real foundation underneath you.
This is such a gift that you have given me.
It's amazing that you guys can do this.
Wow. How could I not know this?
The more you know about history, the more you know about yourself.
My God, that's a story right there. Story of my
life. Thank you. Thank you. And now, so how did a guy with, I have a BA in history and a PhD in English language and literature from the University of Cambridge. How did a person with those credentials start doing a TV show talking about ancestry? Well, it all started on the day that I met this lady. When you see me looking down, it's because I have a monitor right here. And that's Jane Gates. That is my great-great-grandmother. As you can see, she was born in 1819. She died in 1888. Now, obviously, I didn't meet her literally, but it was the day that I saw this photograph, and I'll never forget it. Jane Gates had four children. This is her son, Edward Gates, who's my great-grandfather, and his wife, Maudalene Scott. That's on our farm in West Virginia, and I grew up very near there. She had five children. They all were very fair. They all looked white. And she never told them who their father was. She just told them that they had the same father. And she took the secret of that man's identity to her grave. He, Edward Gates, died 5 years before I was born. And there's a close-up of him. This is where all my family lives, halfway between Pittsburgh and Washington, D.C. All my family, on all branches of my family tree, has lived within an 18-mile radius of where I was born, going back 200 years. Three sets of my fourth-grade grandparents, whom you'll meet a little bit later, lived in right there. Wait a minute. Go back. Right. There's Cumberland, Maryland, Piedmont, West Virginia, Patterson's Creek, West Virginia. In that cluster, all of my family has lived for 200 years. I'm a Redman on my mother's side of the family, and I'm a Redman on my father's side of the family, which might explain my peculiar quirks. Well, Edward Gates Sr. had five children, and five children, and his son was Edward St. Lawrence Gates. And you're looking at his baby picture. That is my grandfather. And my grandfather had eight children, seven sons, and that's his seventh son, my daddy, Henry Louis Gates Sr., who lived to be 97 and a half, and who passed in the year 2010. Well, we were at the funeral, July 3rd, 1960, of his father, Pop Gates. And we were at the Kite Funeral Home in Cumberland, Maryland. And I was standing, holding my father's hand, standing, looking at the open casket of his father. It's the closest I had ever been to a corpse. And I was terrified. Because, you know, he was dead. I'd never been that close to a corpse, right? And then I looked at him and I thought how ridiculous he looked. My grandfather was so white when he was alive, with blood coursing through his veins, that we called him Casper behind his back. So you can imagine, if he was that white living, how white he was dead. He looked like he'd been coated with alabaster and sprinkled with baby powder. And I was looking at him, and I thought, he looks ridiculous. And I heard a noise come out of my father, and I thought my father was laughing at some mistake that the undertaker apparently had made with makeup. And so I started to laugh too. Now you'd think, what kind of idiot's gonna be laughing at a funeral home, 200 people in this funeral home, laughing in front of their grandfather's casket, in front of his corpse. Well, the reason is because my father was so funny. My father was the funniest human being I've ever met. My father made Red Fox look like an undertaker. So I thought he was laughing and we were sharing the joke. And I looked up to share the joke, and to my enormous embarrassment, my father wasn't laughing at all. The noise I heard, he was crying. I mean, he began to weep. And fortunately, because everyone was so transfixed on the funny man, my dad, crying for the first time in public, no one noticed that I had been cracking up at how white his father looked. And I was so shocked and so embarrassed that when I looked at him, I broke out in tears. I burst out crying too. So it was very traumatic. And we went over to the Episcopal Cemetery and the Rose Hill Cemetery in Cumberland, Maryland, and we buried Pop Gates. And then we came back to the Gates family home, which this woman, Jane Gates, purchased. Jane Gates was a slave till 1865. In 1870, she plopped down $1,200 in cash in an all-white neighborhood in Cumberland, Maryland, and bought a house. And my cousin Johnny Gates still owns that house. So we went back to the Gates family house. And I just have one brother, Dr. Paul Gates, who's the chief of dentistry at Bronx Lebanon Hospital. He's 5 years older than I am. Daddy said, "There's something I want to show you boys." And he took us upstairs in the Gates family home. His parents had, their bedroom had a sun porch. And he took us out on this sun porch. I had never even been upstairs at my grandparents' house. I don't know about you all, but you couldn't go upstairs in your grandparents' house. You know, it just wasn't done. They just disappeared magically upstairs. It's kind of like Harry Potter. I never knew where they went. So we go upstairs. We go out on the sun porch, and there was a big armoire out there, and Daddy opened it, and it was full of bank ledgers. And it was full of bank ledgers because my grandfather was a janitor to the First National Bank in Cumberland, Maryland, and he was stealing these bank ledgers. But I didn't. My brother and I compared notes later, and we thought, well, maybe they were going to, Daddy was telling us about the family fortune or something. So he starts taking these bank ledgers out of the armoire, and he's on the floor pulling these books out, and Rocky, my brother and I, are surrounding him, and he's turning the pages furiously. He's obviously looking for something. He pulls out 5 volumes, 6 volumes, 7. Finally, he finds what he's looking for. And you know what it was? It was an obituary. And the obituary was dated January 6, 1888. And it said, died this day in Cumberland, Maryland, Jane Gates, an estimable colored woman. An estimable colored woman. And then he pulled this photograph out between the leaves of the bank ledger. And he said, this is the oldest Gates we've ever been able to trace. She was a slave. I never want you to forget her identity. And so my brother and I looked at this woman. She was a midwife, and she's dressed in her midwifery costume. And he said, I never want you to forget her name. I never want you to forget that face. And then with that, he put the photograph back in the book. He shut it. He gathered all the other bank ledgers off the floor, put them in the armoire, and we went downstairs for the repast. And that night, we drove back 25 miles to Piedmont, West Virginia. And the obituary had said that Jane was an estimable colored woman. An estimable colored woman. That whole way back, I kept thinking, estimable, estimable. And I went upstairs to bed that night, and my father worked 2 jobs. He worked at a paper mill in the day, and he was a janitor in the evening. And so my brother and I always had our own bedroom, had our own desk, and I had one of those old red Webster's dictionaries right by my bed. And the last thing I did, ladies and gentlemen, before I went to bed, was look up the word estimable, because I didn't know what it meant. And I thought, estimable. Well, if she's estimable, maybe I'm estimable too. The next day was the 4th of July. Piedmont was an Irish-Italian paper mill town, a handful of black people, 386 black people, according to the 1950 census. Most of them were my cousins, right? And despite the fact that there were so few black people, or maybe because there were so few black people, schools integrated a year after Brown v. Board. Brown v. Board's 1954, schools integrated in 1955. And so I went to integrated schools my whole life. But everybody in town worked at the paper mill, right? But there was a black section of the paper mill, black occupations, black jobs, and there were black social events. So we could go to school, but there was a big mill picnic and a big 4th of July picnic, and there was a colored picnic, and there was a white picnic. So we went to the colored picnic, and on the way back, I asked my dad if he would buy me a notebook. And we stopped at Red Bull's newsstand, and he was of Irish descent, and I got this little composition book. And that night, in front of our little black and white 12-inch RCA Victor TV, I interviewed my parents about what I would only later learn is called one's family tree or one's genealogy. Because I wanted to know how I was connected to this woman. This woman who looked African to me. She couldn't have been born in Africa because the slave trade to the United States ends in 1819. But for us, she was as close to Africa as we possibly could come. And I wondered what her experience had been like. And I couldn't figure out how she could have that complexion, that phenotype, and have a grandson who looked like, as we would say behind his back, a ghost. And that's when I made my first family tree. Now, I was only 9 years old, and I would lose the composition book. every few years, though, I would be interested again in tracing my roots. And so I'd buy another composition book. I would interview my parents in front of our TV at night, and they would get me back, connect me to Jane Gates on my dad's side, and to my great-great-grandmother and great-great-grandfather on my mom's side. Well, I didn't think too much about it, but it was something that was sort of there. It nagged at me all the time. Cut to 1977. What's the biggest thing in the history of television? Roots. You could say that since 1977, I've had a serious case of roots envy. I hated Alex Haley. I wanted to be like Alex Haley Otis. I wanted to trace my ancestor back to the slave ship that, you know, had come over from Africa in the Middle Passage. I wanted to know all the African-American ancestors. Then I wanted to reverse the Middle Passage and find the tribe or ethnic group that I was from. But nobody could do that, right? Only Alex Haley. I even met Alex Haley through my friend Quincy Jones. And I would look at him and I was smiling. And I was thinking, man, how'd you get there? You know? Well, cut to the year 2000. I get a letter. You know, the Bible says be careful what you wish for, right? Open my mail. I get a letter from a black guy who teaches at Howard University. He's a geneticist. Dear Dr. Gates, have you ever seen Roots? And I was thinking, what kind of idiot do you think I am? Have you ever seen Roots? He said, today, we can do in a test tube, in a laboratory, what Alex Haley did for himself. And we're looking for volunteers. This is the year 2000. And we can't get volunteers. I was thinking, what's wrong with my people? Because like, I am dying to do this. I picked up the phone and called this guy. I got him in his lab. His name's Dr. Rick Kittles. And I said, I will pay you if you fly up to Harvard, come to Cambridge, come to my house tomorrow, drop whatever it costs. I have been tracing my ancestry, or wanting to trace my ancestry, since I was 9 years old. And he said, okay. So he came up and gave me this whole spiel about how DNA works and mitochondrial DNA, which you inherit from your mother, and how you can trace it all the way back, and we could finally find out where I was from in Africa. And I said, fabulous. And he goes, you know, you're the only one to respond to my letter. And I go, really? He goes, yeah, the only one. And I finally figured out why that was true. If you could see, you're in the front row, you can see my veins here. I have really great veins, right? I had a couple hip replacements. Nobody has ever had trouble finding my veins, except for Dr. Rick Kittles. Now, as you know, you just spit in a test tube. Then, to get a sufficient amount of tissue, they had to take your blood. Now, Rick Kittles is many things, brilliant geneticist, but he didn't know anything about extracting blood. And after 45 minutes of this brother poking around my arm, I said, you know what? I don't want to know where I'm from Africa. I don't want my Kunta Kinte moment that badly. Finally, he got enough blood. And I tell my students this, they do not believe what I'm about to say. He put it in a cooler, just like, you know, styrofoam thing that you put a couple beers in with dry ice. We hailed a taxi in Harvard Square. He went to Logan Airport and walked through, no security. Remember, this is pre-9/11. And just got on the plane with my blood. Just put it up there, everything was cool. I didn't hear anything from Rick Kittles for 6 months. And I start to call him. I go, Rick, how long does this process take? You know, where am I from? In Africa? I don't hear anything. I write to him, I call. Finally, a friend of mine said, just call him from another number. Ding. So I called him from, I swear to God, this is a true story. I called him from another number, phone rang, he goes, Rick Kittles. I go, Rick, where am I from in Africa? He said, man, I was just about to call you. He said, we have tested 2,000 people, and you are the only one descended from the Nubian people. Now, the Nubians were the black pharaohs, the 25th dynasty in Egypt, between about 750 BC and about 650 BC. And all the black nationalists, all the Afrocentrists, want to be descended from the Nubians, right? You want to be descended from the pharaohs. And he said, you are the only one. And he said, that's why I haven't been in touch, because we wanted to test the results. They're so unusual, but I'm sure that that's the way it is. And then he sent me a certificate. You are descended from the Nubian people, Nubian pharaohs. So I thought that was pretty cool. And I showed my best friend, Kwame Anthony Appiah, who's the great philosopher, whose uncle was the Asantehene, the king of the Asante in what's now Ghana. I said, Kwame, look at this. I am descended from the pharaoh. He looked at me and said, what a ton of rubbish. I go, you're just jealous, man. I am descended from the pharaohs. A little bit later, so I hung up my framed letter of authenticity. Got up in the middle of the night. I don't want to embarrass anybody, but I got up to go to the bathroom. And I'm standing in the bathroom, and I got this idea that basically changed my life. It was a gift from God, and that's the only way I could put it. All of a sudden, like a bolt of lightning, it occurred to me that I could pair these twin passions that I had. This desire to know my ancestry, which had been born when I was 9 years old, the day I saw my grandfather's corpse in a casket. I could pair it with this new science of DNA tracing, ancestry tracing through DNA, and I could do a TV show. I would get 8 prominent African Americans, and I would trace their ancestry back as far as I possibly could, using the historical record, following the paper trail. And then when the paper trail ran out, I would analyze their DNA and reveal what ethnic group they were from in Africa. I was so excited, I swear, tears ran down my face. Heart could hardly sleep. Next day I said, I gotta call Quincy Jones. Quincy had scored the music for Roots, we always forget that, and had become obsessed with his own ancestry. And he and I, his daughter Rashida, remember from Parks and Recreation, was my student, he and I were just friends, we were good buddies. Now Quincy, because he's a jazz musician, is up all night. So you can't do business with Quincy till 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I waited till 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I could hardly stand it, and finally I called Quincy Jones. And I said, Q, what if I could do for you what Alex Haley did for himself? He said, can you do that? I go, yeah, man, do the new science of DNA. He said, I got one question. I said, what? He said, does it hurt? And I did what you would have done, ladies and gentlemen. I lied. I said, no, man, it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt at all. I said, are you in? He said, I'm in. I said, okay. Now, I wanted to wait because, you see, I wanted Quincy in because he's Quincy Jones. He's my friend. But also, you know why else? Who's Quincy Jones' best friend? Does anybody know? Oprah Winfrey. Now, I didn't want to embarrass myself or appear to be vulgar or opportunistic, so I waited at least 45 seconds, which I counted out as slowly as I possibly could. And then I said, Q, would you ask Oprah if she'd be in the series? He goes, no. He said, but I'll do you one better. I'll give you Oprah's secret name and address. And I go, well, what am I supposed to do with that, Q? He said, write her a letter, dummy. I go, a snail mail letter. I thought, man, I've gotten the brush off in complex ways, all kinds of ways, but never like this. And I decided, well, this idea was never meant to be. I went to bed, thought, well, not gonna happen. Next day I said, what the heck, I'm gonna sit down and write Oprah Winfrey a letter. So I sat down, I'd met Oprah briefly for like 5 seconds with Quincy Jones at a Cuban restaurant in Miami, but she didn't even sit down. She came in, she had a limo about as long as this auditorium. She got out of it like this angel, came over the table, sort of patted me on the head, and then left. So I just, you know, there was no intimate card to play, and I said, dear Miss Winfrey, I'm Henry Louis Gates, I have this idea, Quincy gave me your blah, 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 blah. And I sealed the envelope, took it to the post office in the square, mailed it myself, and waited. And I waited, and I waited, and I waited. Nothing. I thought it was like putting a message in a bottle. Tossing it into the Atlantic Ocean. I got nothing back from Oprah. So I gave up. I was sitting there watching Sunday football, grading papers, and my cell phone rang. And I looked down, it was Quincy Jones. And I go, Q, what's up? And a deep woman's voice said, Dr. Gates, this is Oprah Winfrey. I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Why? Because rich people don't call you with bad news. If you're waiting to see if you got that promotion, right? And attendant number 29 calls you to get the promotion. The boss calls you, you did. I knew I was in, and I was so happy. Why did I need Oprah and Quincy? Because I needed $6 million to do what became African American Lives. I got Whoopi Goldberg heard about it, called my office about 15 times, so I let her in. And believe me, I didn't even know what I was doing. I wanted to disappoint expectations about black people. I didn't want to have all entertainers and athletes, right? So I wanted to have a doctor. And I was thinking, what doctors do I know? Well, just so happens one of my classmates from Yale, class 73, was a prominent doctor. In fact, he was a neurosurgeon. In fact, he was the first person successfully to separate Siamese twins joined at the brain. I met him in September 69. His name, I think he's secretary of what? Housing. Little nerdy guy named Ben. What's his name? Ben Carson, right? Mae Jemison, medical doctor, Stanford graduate, first black female astronaut. That's what I'm talking about. Quincy in the middle, there's Oprah. Bishop T.D. Jakes, also from West Virginia. Very few black people from West Virginia. And black people are such a range of phenotypes that I wanted someone darker and lighter and in the middle. And T.D. fit the bill. Plus, I wanted a man of the cloth. So I asked T.D. Jakes and Chris Tucker, the great comedian, and Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot. And we premiered African American Lives. It was a huge hit. 8 million people watched African American Lives. So PBS asked me to do a sequel. So I said, okay. So I reached out to Morgan Freeman and to Tina Turner. I have to admit, I have a thing about Tina Turner. I wanted to do her DNA myself, but she wouldn't let me. I did my best. Tom Joyner, Chris Rock, and it was a big success. So then I get a letter, appropriately enough to tell you this story in the synagogue. I get this letter from a Jewish lady. It said, Dear Dr. Gates, I've always admired you, but I finally decided you're a big fat racist. And you're a racist because you won't trace the ancestry of immigrants. You won't trace the ancestry of people like me who is from Eastern Europe. Why don't you do that? I thought, wow, could I trace the ancestry of white people? My brand is black, right? That's what I get paid to teach black study. Could I do this? So Coca-Cola was my sponsor, and I decided, well, I'll call our account executive. And her name is Ingrid Saunders Jones. And I called her, African-American woman, and I got her on her cell phone. And I said, Ingrid, I'm holding a letter from this Jewish lady who just called me a racist because we won't do white people in what was then called African American Lives. Can I trace the ancestry of white people? And you know, ladies and gentlemen, I thought the call dropped because it was silent. And I thought, well, I guess the answer is no. I kept saying, Ingrid, the call was still, clock was still ticking. And I couldn't figure out what was going on. Only later I realized that she had been in a meeting in a conference room and got up to walk down the hall because she didn't want anybody to overhear. And right when I was ready to hang up, I go, Ingrid, are you there? And she, a little voice said, well, Skip, there's only one thing that I could say. And I said, what? She said, there are a lot more white people drinking Coke than black people. I took that as a yes. So then I had to deal with, how do you pick white people? I know how to pick black people. I've been black all these years. Now I had to pick white people. And then I figured, well, if this Jewish lady wrote to me, some Asian person's gonna write to me. West Indians have been on me because I hadn't put any West Indians in. What about Muslims? So I decided to do what Noah would do. Two Asians, two Catholics. Ashkenazi Jew, Sephardi Jew. And that's what we did. We had Yo-Yo Ma's Chinese and Christy Yamaguchi, who's Japanese, Malcolm Gladwell, whose mother's of West Indians, everyone knows, and Elizabeth Alexander read the poem at President Obama's first election. She's a Jamaican too. Mario Batali, who's Italian. My man, Stephen Colbert, who was, the Irish nationalist. And we did Faces of America, which morphed into Finding Your Roots. And now we have, one of the most popular shows in the history of PBS. And it's something I'm very proud of. And it's something that's designed to bring people together and to show us that beneath the superficial differences, that we're all united and we're all members of one big family. So I'm very proud of it. Now I just want to show you a few more, share with you a few lessons that I've learned along the way, and end with a couple stories about immigration, and then we're going to do our conversation. And I'm getting the signal from the man. Great. One of the things that we were able to do is we were able to count the slaves. It was capitalism, after all, and all these records still exist. And now we know that there were 12.5 million Africans put on ships between 1501 and 1866 who came to the New World. 15% died in the Middle Passage. That means 10.8 million Africans arrived safely in the New World. How many came to the United States? How many came to the United States out of that 10.8 million? Anyone from this side? Half a million? How many over here? 400,000, is that all? How many here? 10 million got off the boats. 5 million, thank you. 388,000. Only 388,000 Africans came to the United States. All the rest went to places south of Key West. 5 million went to Brazil. 1 million went to Jamaica. 1 million went to Cuba. 779,000 went to Saint-Domingue, which in 1804 became the Republic of Haiti. It's incredible, and nobody knew this until we actually counted the slaves. And we also know where they came from. We know that 16% came from eastern Nigeria. We know that 24% came from what's now Angola. We know that 24% came from the area that is Senegal and Gambia. So if I did the DNA of all the black people in this room, 16% would come from ethnic groups from Nigeria, 24% from ethnic groups in Angola. It's incredible that we now have that data. We even can break it down to know that if your African ancestor arrived in the Chesapeake region, the eastern shore of Maryland, we know the countries and the ethnic groups that they came from. If they arrived through Florida and the Gulf Coast, we know where they came from. If they arrived in New England, we know where they came from. We know where those million slaves who went to Jamaica came from, those 773,000 who went to Haiti, where they came from. And now, we've found another 200,000 since I made this slide who went to Cuba, and the almost 5 million Africans who went to Brazil. The real African-American experience in the New World unfolded south of Florida, not in the United States as we were raised to believe. And as this is just another way of recapitulating those statistics, 14% of the Africans who came to the United States came from what's now Ghana, 5% from Liberia and the Ivory Coast, and 2.2% as far away as Angola, and Mozambique, I'm sorry. How American are the African people? Well, by 1700, 3.9% of our ancestors had arrived. By 1775, 72% had arrived. By 1800, almost 80% of our ancestors had arrived. And by 1820, 99%. The African American people are as American as you can get. Here are a couple of amazing facts, too. In 1860, the year before the Civil War broke out, there were 3.9 million enslaved human beings in this country. And there were 488,000 free people of color. But here's the hoot. of those free people of color, more lived in the Confederacy than lived in the North. 225,000 lived in the free states, 261,000 lived in the Confederacy and stayed there during the whole Civil War. Completely counterintuitive. Why? Because if you were freed, the master in many states had to give you land. When Joe and Sarah Bruce, my fourth great grandparents, were freed in Western Virginia, Abraham Van Meter, in his will of 1823, gave them 1,000 acres. We still own some of that property. So what are you going to do? Leave your property? Leave your unfree family members? And what? Be homeless in Philadelphia, New York, or Boston? You stayed. And they stayed during the whole Civil War. We give all of the guests in Finding Your Roots 4 DNA tests. We test their Y DNA, which every man gets from his father, your mitochondrial DNA, which you men and women get from their mother. We test your admixture, your percentages of Sub-Saharan, African, Asian, Native American, and European ancestry, and your autosomal DNA. This is how it works. You get your Y DNA, you saw those white looking men, my father, my grandfather, my great grandfather. We have the same Y DNA signature. My mama, God rest her soul, gave me and my brother her mitochondrial DNA, and it goes back thousands of years with hardly any transformation at all. We find out the identity of your ancestry by seeing if your DNA matches the DNA of a person from, say, Ireland, or an Ashkenazi Jewish person. If you share certain markers, ancestry informative markers, and that's how it matches, that's how matching actually works. You can tell if you're related to someone in this room because you share long segments of DNA. It's called being identical by descent. And it means that it's not an accident that if you share long segments of identical DNA, you definitely share a common recent ancestor with someone, whether you know how you do or not. Most people in this room will not share any DNA with each other. But if you do, as in this diagram, the brother and sister in the middle have children, may marry someone else, and you see in the bottom level, the IBD segment, that orange DNA, which they have inherited from their ancestors. That, in a nutshell, is how it works. This is how a second cousin relationship. This woman, Helen Lee, is my second cousin. She's a professor at MIT, and that is the DNA that we share across our 23 chromosomes. Again, it's not arbitrary, it's not accidental, it's why she is my cousin. And this, to show you the wonders of intermarriage and breeding, that is her son, whose father is from Guam, and that little girl is my granddaughter. My daughter, but the mother of my children is a white American. I am 50% European and 50% African-American, or of African descent. So my children are 75% European, and my daughter married a white guy, and that is their daughter, Eleanor Margaret Gates Hatley, who is 2 years old, and who is the fourth great granddaughter of the woman that you saw in the first slide, Jane Gates, who's a slave. And legally, she is black. In fact, when my son-in-law came back from the hospital, I said, you know, how's Maggie? How's the baby? He said, great. I said, you checked the box, didn't you? He said, huh? I said, you checked the box. He goes, I checked the box. The box meaning black. And we were, you know, it's crazy, but the law of hypodescent, as it's called, it still obtains in the United States. If you have a legal black ancestor, you're still black, no matter what you look like, no matter what the admixture says. I'll end with the three great myths of African-American genealogy that I have learned doing this series. First is that we are descended from a princess, a prince or a princess. Usually it's an Igbo princess. would be from Nigeria. Now, as I said, 16% of us come from Africans who came from Eastern Nigeria, and that's where the Igbo people were, so okay, that's not bad. The second one is related to this. We were never slaves. First time I heard this was from a woman, very prominent African-American woman on Martha's Vineyard, and I'm at their house, and I'm doing the series, and I ask her if she's cooking. And I said, how far back can you trace your ancestry into slavery? And she stops stirring the pot, and she goes, we were never slaves. And I look, I wanted to bust out laughing in her face, but I was hungry. So I said, okay, educate me. How did you get here? Obviously, you didn't come on the Mayflower. You know, how did you get here? She goes, well, Mr. Smarty Pants, there was, my ancestry came in through Charleston. And I was shocked, because most of us don't know, 48% of all Africans entered the United States through Charleston, South Carolina. 48%. So that's pretty good that she knew that, right? So I go, okay. And she said, a German baron was walking by Charleston Harbor, and he looked over, and there was a slave ship, and all the slaves were getting off, and there was this beautiful woman. It turns out she was an Igbo princess. And this German baron said, my, look at that fine Igbo princess. And he went over to the slave ship captain and said, how much for this woman? He told her, he plopped out the money, he bought her, they fell in love, they moved to the north, and they lived happily ever after. And I thought, wow, man, that is a story. And I went, that is, man, you believe that story. So I said, well, what do I know? You know, maybe it's possible. She did know about Charleston. The next day, I called Malcolm Gladwell to see if he would be in the series that became Faces of America. And I knew, as I said earlier, that Malcolm's father's English, Malcolm of English descent, Malcolm's mother's a Jamaican. And I said, Malcolm, what do you know about your ancestry? He said, well, it's interesting. I only know one story. I said, what's that? He said, I'm descended from this Igbo princess. I said, really? He goes, yeah, you know. I go, tell me the story. He said, well, there was this German baron. He was walking along this thing. I go, okay. Never happened. No Igbo princess, no German baron. Finally, have I told you about my Cherokee great-great-grandma? How many black people in here, just the black people, I'm going to look out here, how many black people know that you have Native American ancestry? Ladies and gentlemen, all the black people in here just raise their hand. None of y'all got Native American ancestry. None of you. None. Zero. The average slave and the average Native American never even saw each other. We created this myth that, you know, our ancestors ran away over the hill, and there's a bunch of Indians over there, and they were smoking the peace pipe. The chief said, wow, fine, healthy African-American brother. Let us bond around the peace pipe. Here's my daughter. Why don't you marry and come into the tribe? Forget it. Average African-American, the average Native American never saw each other. The five civilized tribes, Creek, the Cherokee, Choctaw, Chickasaw, and the Seminole, were called the civilized tribes. They were the Trail of Tears. They were the five tribes that were removed after Andrew Jackson signed the the Indian Removal Act, right? Why? Because they were sitting on the richest cotton-growing soil in the world. And that their removal led to the cotton boom after 1830. They were called civilized. They embraced Christianity, English language, and they owned black slaves. So if you were owned by one of them, you got a shot. But forget it. My Uncle David, my mother's brother, I'd say, Arky, you know, when I did the first series and they revealed my DNA, which I'm going to share with you in a minute, the family had a meeting. And said, the Coleman family, and said, Skippy, we tired of that stuff, you lies you've been spreading on television. Here's a picture. They had all these pictures. This is a picture of Granny, my great-grandma. Look at those high cheekbones and that straight black hair. Now, you know, okay, I said, okay. What tribe were they from? They go, Cherokee. I go, no. The Cherokee were in the South. We're all from West Virginia. We've been there for 200 years. And my Uncle David was very quick, said, yeah, that's right. Not Cherokee. They were Iroquois. I go, wrong. They were up. They were up in the North. The average African American is 73% African and 23% European, and less than 1% Native American ancestor. The reason your ancestor had high cheekbones and straight black hair was because all that European ancestry. I asked Chris Rock on camera, how come we have this fantasy of Native American ancestry? He said, it's easy to imagine a mythic origin than to think about rape or cajoled sexuality. Now, it can't be every time a white and black person slept together in slavery. I'm sure not every time was rape, but overwhelmingly, it just had to be. And you have to ask yourself, can you love and have an equal relationship with someone you actually own? There are exceptions. When I did Morgan Freeman's family tree, his great-great-grandmother's impregnated by the white overseer on the plantation in Mississippi. Clearly rape, right? Except we found their gravestones. They lived common law after the end of the Civil War. They lived together till they died. They had children, and they were buried in the colored cemetery, as we would have said then, back in this county in Mississippi, so go figure. But by and large, it was a result of enforced sexuality, red rape, and that's why we have this myth. If I did the DNA of all the men, black men in this room, 35% of you, like me, descend from a white man, not a black man at all. A white man who impregnated a black woman during slavery. 35%. So if I did all the guys on the Cavs, all the guys in the NBA, all the black men in Harlem, it doesn't matter. 35% descend, like I do, from a white man, which is why Jane Gates' children all looked the way that they did. Let me end with a story about immigration. And by the way, if you want to know why Rick Kittles said that I was Nubia, remember the anecdote that we started with? This is a map of my mitochondrial DNA matches. Look at Africa. You see any matches? There, if you looked closely, there's one pink match at the mouth of the Nile River. Look at Europe. It looks like Europe has smallpox. I am descended not only from a white man who impregnated Jane Gates, who, by the way, was Irish, as we know from my Y-DNA. I'm descended from a white woman who slept with a black man, an indentured servant from England or Ireland, who was impregnated by a black man during slavery. And the reason I called Rick when I finally got this new result, and I said, why'd you say that I was Nubian? He goes, well, there is one match that you have there in Egypt, which is, you know, Nubia was right down there. And he said, man, you wanted to be black so bad to find your tribe. I didn't want to hurt your feelings. I go, thank you very much. I didn't need that. And by the way, if you have the test, you can find out if you have any Neanderthal ancestry. I'm 1.7% Neanderthal, and that enters my genome through my European ancestry, because Africans and Neanderthals didn't sleep together. Only you people were sleeping with up there cavorting with the Neanderthals in Northern Europe. This is my family tree. I'm the most DNA tested black man in the history of the world. And armies of genealogists have traced my ancestry. And it goes back to three sets of fourth great grandparents who were free Negroes. One, John Redmond, fought in the American Revolution. He mustered into the Continental Army on Christmas Day of 1778, was mustered out in April of 1784. And they, as I said earlier, all lived within an 18-mile region of where I was born. I always end with some of the coolest stories, but these three stories about immigration, and then I'll stop. These are news stories. The ones heard this before, it'll be in the news season. The first is Scarlett Johansson. Her great-grandfather, Saul Schlumberg, was born between 1887 and 1895 in Poland, in a Jewish shtetl, which was then part of the Russian Empire. Saul sailed from Rotterdam on the SS New Amsterdam, arrived in New York City May 28, 1910. He settled with his wife Molly on the Lower East Side, working in a grocery. His son Meyer Schlumberg, Scarlett's grandfather, was born April 20th, 1919. In 1940, Saul left his family and moved out to California. Meyer was drafted in World War II on October 23, 1942, but his father's family, Scarlett's great-granduncle, Moshe Schlumberg, his wife and their children, remained in Poland. They were transported in late February 1941 to the Warsaw Ghetto, where they ultimately perished. Anna Navarro, I just filmed her 2 weeks ago. She was born in Chinandega, Nicaragua. Her family lived in Nicaragua since at least the 19th century. Several of her ancestors were involved in politics. We all remember the Sandinista Revolution. Her family's property was confiscated. They fled from Nicaragua in 1980, settled in Miami, where they raised their family. After the election of President Violeta Chamorro in 1990, Anna's parents, Jose Navarro Callejas and Violeta Baca Alvarado, returned to Nicaragua. Jose became an outspoken politician in Nicaragua, serving as Minister of Agriculture. Anna stayed in the United States, where she is now a political commentator. And John Turturro, his grandfather, Ralph Turturro, was born April 7, 1896, in Giovinazzo, an Italian port town. He came to America the first time in 1911, working in Mount Vernon, New York, until 1914. Ralph returned to Italy in time for the outbreak of World War I. He served in the Italian Navy as a gun pointer, reaching the rank of sottocapo, a junior non-commissioned officer. He then crossed the Atlantic twice more, living in New York from 1923 to 24, returning to Italy for a spell, and arriving in New York for good on January 9, 1925. Ralph settled on the Lower East Side and became an American citizen on November 10, 1930. His wife Angelina and son Nick, John's father, arrived a little over a year later. When Ralph had left Italy, Angelina had been pregnant with their son. Nick met Ralph for the first time December 19, 1931 at age 6. Ralph and Nick both worked as contractors. Nick served in the U.S. Navy in World War II. Along with 40 other scholars, I've raised just about $1 million to teach inner city kids the wonders of ancestry tracing and DNA. These are all my colleagues. And we had our first summer camp, three summer camps last summer, and we're going to have the second one this summer. Why are we doing this? If Otis Moss himself and I walked into an inner city school and said today's lesson is Watson and Crick and DNA, or the history of immigration through Ellis Island, or the role of the concentration camps in World War II, people would say, all that old stuff, boring, get out of town. We walk in with a Q-tip. You say, see this swab? We're going to swab your cheek. In 6 weeks, we're going to tell you your ethnic ancestry. And we're going to tell you, if you're black, what ethnic group you're from, what tribe you're from. Who wouldn't be interested in that? Then we're going to go down the hall to the social studies class. And we're going to have each kid in the class trace their ancestry, learning how to use the censuses, going on the internet and using the census and going back to 1870, when all African Americans for the first time appeared in a federal census. And then we're going to teach them how to go back to 1860 and look at the slave schedule and look for people with the same surname, like Absalom Winfrey, who turns out owned Oprah Winfrey's great-great-grandfather, and see if he owned a slave, a male slave 10 years younger than Constantine Winfrey was in the 1870 census. Using the power of ancestry tracing, we want to reignite the love of learning that so many inner city black kids have lost. When Otis was growing up, when I was growing up, the blackest thing you could be was an educated man or an educated woman. Being a basketball player was fine, being an entertainer was fine, but the heroes that we celebrated were Dr. Du Bois and Mary McLeod Bethune, black lawyers, black doctors, black dentists. We aspired. One of the saddest things I've ever seen is a result of a poll, the Washington Post, that listed things white. You know what was on the list? Speaking standard English, getting straight A's in school, and visiting the Smithsonian. If anyone had said that kind of thing when we were growing up, your mama would have smacked you upside your head and said, well, are you crazy? Dr. King gave his life so that we could enter great halls of learning such as this. Frederick Douglass famously wrote that the slaves had to steal a little learning from the white man. And somehow, in such an unfortunate segment of our population, learning has not become the valued thing that it used to be. I want to use the magic of ancestry tracing to turn this around. After all, what's your favorite subject? Your favorite subject is yourself. And tracing your roots is all about learning about yourself. What person is not going to be interested in this? What person's imagination is not going to be fueled? I don't know if it's going to save our people and turn everything around. I can't pretend to claim that. But I do know that I think we have a good shot at reigniting that love of learning. And the reason that I do it is not to take our people back to the future, but to reawake that love of learning to take our people black to the future. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Well, that was wonderful. I have to say that I'm glad that back in the green room I didn't tell you the story about my great-great-grandmother, the Igbo princess. But I wanted to just maybe lead off with a question here, and then we can take a couple of questions from the audience. There are microphones, I think, on either side, and I believe there's one up in the balcony, too, though I cannot see you. But you know, through your shows, you've been able to reach millions of people. And I would say that probably most people would agree that one of the basic takeaways is the interconnectedness of us as human beings. And how can you be afraid of something that you're connected to? So maybe you could reflect a bit on what it's like now when, that interconnectedness used to be a matter of faith. Now it's a matter of science. And we're in a time when we're being asked to reject science and accept fear.
Well, that's a good question. I was thinking about Frederick Douglass's speech at Reserve in 1854 when science was demanding that people reject what they could see. Science, pseudoscience, was pretending that races were essences. That if you were white, there was a stream of whiteness, Europeanness. If you were African, there was a stream of Africanness. If you were Native American, and that there was no blending. And one of the things that we know from admixture results is that no matter what the law was in the day, when the lights came down, everybody was sleeping with everybody else. That is it. I mean, the quickest way to get somebody to sleep with the other is to tell them that they can't. You know, all they do is obsess. You're a teenager. All you do is obsess about, don't sleep with those so-and-so. You go, oh, my God, that must be good. I want some of that. But it bothers people. Now, one of my family members, what we're trying to do is test all the living descendants of Jane Gates. Because we could do things now with DNA that didn't even exist when I first did African-American Lives in 2005. So, like autosomal DNA. At the end, I always tell a guest if they're related to anyone else that's ever been in the series. Ashkenazi Jews have more cousins than anybody in the world because they've been sleeping with, their cousins have been sleeping with each other for 1,000 years. The gene pool has been, it was confined through ghettos, as they were called, and that's why you have things like Tay-Sachs disease, right? Because cousins have been sleeping with cousins. So Ashkenazi Jews are always related to somebody in the series, but you get surprising mixtures. So I gave it to my cousin, the woman who's a professor at MIT, Helen, whom you saw on this slide. And she's 63% European, and it just drove her crazy. You know, she just was so upset. She wrote me, we were on spring break last week, and she goes,
I want to unknow this fact. I go, what's wrong with you? You know, like, look at your mother, look at your father. We're mixed. We are mixed. And so what I'm trying to do is deconstruct the notion of race by using science and popularizing it. So everything we do is vetted by the Broad Institute at Harvard and MIT, some of the world's greatest geneticists, so that we get all the facts right. And you can see how blended we all are. Basically, an admixture test tells you your percentage of ancestors who were black or African or European or Native American. Now there's 60 subcategories, but I didn't have time to go into that. And you know, you could find out your percentage of Ashkenazi Jewish ancestry back 500 years. And almost never do we get someone who's 100% this or 100% that, which means that if we could populate your family tree ideally, you would find somebody there who doesn't look like somebody else. It doesn't mean that everybody here has a black ancestor. If you go back 50,000 years, you all have black ancestors because we all came from the out-migration of Africa 50,000 years ago, but not 500 years ago. But very rarely do you find someone who is quote-unquote pure, only meaning all of their ancestors for the last 500 years have been from the same tribe, like the tribe of Ireland or the tribe of Italy or the tribe of the Czech, what's now the Czech Republic. And I'm speaking anachronistically, of course, because these places didn't exist 500 years ago, but that's the trap of language. So that my hope is that if we realize that we've all been sleeping with each other, that we all, our genomes reflect the great diversity in this room and in Cleveland and in the United States and indeed in the world, that that'll make us more tolerant. I thought that we were talking earlier about Martin Luther King's famous quote about the arc of the universe bends toward justice. And I really thought that we had passed a certain point in the history of the United States. And it just turns out that we haven't. But you know, my next history series for PBS is going to be on Reconstruction. Reconstruction is the freest time in the history of black people, 1866 to 1876. Black people were freed by the 13th Amendment, which is finally ratified in December 1865. Then black men get to vote because, you know, women couldn't vote. And they're black members of the House of Representatives, black senators. There's been a black lieutenant governor who's governor, PBS Pinchback, for 30 days in Louisiana. You know, the millennium had come, right? And we were bound for glory. And what happened? The Hayes-Tilden Compromise, 1877. Rutherford B. Hayes becomes president of the United States because he agrees, among other things, to take the troops out of the South and essentially to disenfranchise black people. And the birth of the Ku Klux Klan, 1890, the Separate Car Act in Louisiana, the infamous Mississippi Constitutional Convention, the birth of Desiree segregation is the 1890s, and it culminates with Plessy v. Ferguson in 1896. Nobody would have believed that in 1876, right? Nobody. Nobody would have believed some of the things happening in this country the day Barack Obama was elected president. Remember the world of post-racialism? What happened to that? You know, that's gone. And what it means is that those of us who love freedom and those of us who love justice and those of us who believe in this country have to stand tall and proud and fight the forces that are trying to drag us back to an evil, dark world.
Well, I see someone has stepped up to the microphone, and we do have time for one or two questions.
That's because I talk so long. I'm sorry.
Thank you for coming to Cleveland. We've enjoyed you at Annisfield Wolf.
Listen, I love Cleveland. I prayed. I am personally responsible for the Cavs winning that last game. I was jumping up and hooping and hollering.
Everyone looks forward to you at Annisfield Wolf Awards.
Thank you. September 7th, I'll be back.
And we look forward to it. I'm just curious, do you have any, hopefully, some future plans with Barack Obama, a joint project together?
With Barack? Last time I had a joint project, we were drinking a beer together. Every time he sees me, he thinks of that beer, so do I, you know. No, I see him socially, you know, through friends on the Vineyard, and I think there's a rumor that they bought a house on the Vineyard. I'm sure I'll see him. And his daughter is going to be our student. You know, she'll be at Harvard. And, you know, most of the kids take my class, which is called Blackness 101. And in this class, I alluded to it earlier, but I teach, and this is very important in terms of you understanding who I am. Larry Bobo, the great sociologist, and I teach the debates, Otis, that black people have had about what being black has meant since the 18th century. And you know why I do that? I was an undergraduate at Yale in the late 60s and early 70s. There were a bunch of ideological bullies who were there trying to tell me how to be black. Your afro had to be so long. You had to have certain kind of dashiki. You couldn't date white kids. You couldn't have white friends. You couldn't do that. And I got tired of that. You know, I never succumbed to that. I grew up with white friends. I grew up, as you know, in this Appalachian paper mill town. And I wasn't going to let anybody treat me that way. And I said, though I was raised to be a doctor, my mother, you know, God rest her soul, my mother, the father, the son, and a medical doctor, right in heaven. Being a doctor was as close as you could get to the divine. And I was thinking about that, let my parents down by becoming a professor. So it never occurred to me that I would be a professor because I took all these pre-med courses. But then finally I got this fellowship to go to England, and I realized that what I wanted to be all along was a race man and be a professor. Somebody pays me to read and write books. Can't beat that, you know. And then I decided, you know what? I want to teach a course, not just for the black kids wherever I'm teaching, but for all the kids to understand the evils of political correctness, that there never was one way to be anything, and there never was one way to be black. That on the last line in my last lecture is that now you've seen, and in each class we trace the debates that black people had, calling each other out. Martin Luther King, Adam Clayton Powell hated Martin Luther King's guts, and so did Bishop Jackson in Chicago. And my daughter Liza, my younger daughter, used to say, back in the day, Daddy, when our people were united, I go, when was that? You know, like, I must have been in a coma and missed that part. So the last line of my last lecture is, the one thing I want you to remember from this class is that there are 42 million African Americans. That means there are 42 million ways to be black. Don't ever let anybody tell you how to be black. And that is what I really believe. But I want to say one other thing, because I don't want to appear to be...
Can I let me ask a question?
Yeah, you can. But I don't want to appear to be demonizing the people who voted for Donald Trump. Because many of my friends did, the people I grew up with back in that little town. And they're really decent people. They're not racist. They're people who are afraid. The people who were raised to think that their kids would work at the paper mill like our parents did. And that some of us would go to college and then come back and have white collar jobs at the paper mill. And that you could marry the cheerleader you fantasized about when you were in high school, or, you know, the love of your life or whatever. And that world's gone. And people are terrified. And Donald Trump managed to produce a message, unfortunately, that spoke to their fears in a way that led them to vote for him, and in a way that Hillary, who's a very good friend of mine, didn't manage to articulate. So that I don't think it's good for us to make fun of people who are afraid. I think we have to figure out how to speak to their fears. I think they will see that these easy solutions that have been proffered, you know, I'm going to drain the swamp, I'm going to roll back Obama, blah, 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 blah. You know, there's a huge reality check coming. And that's why those of us who are fighting for the principles that I voiced earlier have to be preparing now for a new message that speaks to the urgency of the needs of people who are afraid. That's the way to take the White House back. That's the way to take the House and the Senate back. Not demonizing people, calling them names just because they're white and just because they voted for Donald Trump. That's how I feel. Now, yes, ma'am.
I think, actually, I think I see someone on the balcony. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you, Dr.
And
Gates,
then
so much.
I'm afraid I'm going to have to break it off because Dr. Gates has a little surprise for you.
Oh, okay.
And we want to give him time for that.
So you want me to ask my question? Okay, Dr. Gates, thank you so much for dispelling the myth of the Igbo princess, even though it's breaking my heart. I need you to dispel another myth, especially for those of us who are librarians, that it takes only an hour to do your family genealogy if you just go to any public library. Could you please open the door for us a little bit and tell us a little bit more about that army of researchers who are helping you to put together this series? How
sure.
long does it take, and what are they really looking at?
Sometimes it takes months or longer. It depends on where your ancestors are from. If you're connected to royalty or nobility through any of your various lines, remember you double your ancestors every generation, right? So you have 64 fourth grade grandparents. 64, I can name 246 of mine. That means they're 58, right, that I can't name. But if you go back far enough and you happen to hit that stream that goes back to a king or queen or royal person in Europe, you could go back to Arnulf. You could go back to Charlemagne. You could, you know, it's like gold, because the royalty in Europe and in other places protected bloodlines and they have a paper trail. Yo-Yo Ma is one of my favorite stories. You know, we went back to his 20th great-grandfather. You know, it's amazing. Someone said to me when I started this, well, only Europeans care about ancestry. Man, the Chinese invented ancestry. They were, and look at the Bible. I mean, here we are in the temple, right? All that begats about keeping the bloodline pure. You know, who's who? Who's your daddy? Black people didn't invent that. Jews invented that, you know, in the Old Testament. So if you're African-American, and you only have African-American ancestors, and they were enslaved, if we can get you back to 1820 or 1830, we can get almost everybody, unless a courthouse burned down. We could get almost every African-American. But every African-American we've ever tested has some white ancestry. So the trick for African-Americans is finding out the white people who owned you, to see, and then we track down descendants from those white people, that we match the descendants' DNA against your DNA. And remember when I said, if you share long segments of DNA with another person, that's not arbitrary, that's not an accident. That means you have a common recent ancestor. So that's where your diversity comes from. Eastern European Jews, very, very hard to trace. I met someone here. I'll be speaking at a Jewish genealogical meeting in Florida in July, and there's a woman that we work with who in fact, I'm dedicating my fee for that appearance to her. I mean, I want them to give it to her because she's digitizing records that she's found of Jewish people in the Ukraine or Lithuania, wherever it is, you know, somewhere in Eastern Europe. The advantage of living today is that we're finding more and more records and digitizing them so that you could go to Ancestry.com, and in full disclosure, they're the lead sponsor of my TV show, so I'm not entirely objective about that. But they are, as far as I know, the best portal to access for accessing records. And you just go, it's simple. You just type in the name of an ancestor and it connects you, and then you have to do the hard work of figuring out the narratives. The gift that we bring to people is that if you hire a genealogist, they will give you a big notebook full of records. And it'll have every time your ancestor's name appeared. And you have to provide the narrative. You have to turn data into metaphor. We turn data into narrative. We turn data into stories. And we spend a lot of time doing it. The chief genealogist is a woman who has her own business. Her name is Johnny Cerny, J-O-H-N-I-C-E-R-N-Y @gmail.com. And she would love to trace all of y'all's ancestors. We have priority. But so for some people, we find their family trees in a couple months. And sometimes it takes a year or more, you know, it just depends. I don't know if that's a good enough answer, but you have to go and do it. And it's like crack. I never took crack, don't get me wrong. But it's addictive. And it is seductive, and it's wonderful, and it's, you have that eureka moment. The first time I went to the Family History Library was in the late 80s or early 90s, long before I ever thought of doing this TV series. I'd given a lecture at the Utah Academy of Arts and Sciences on a Friday night in Salt Lake City. And I woke up, you know, when you go west and you wake up in basically the middle of the night because your clock is off. So I woke up 5 o'clock and said, and my flight back to, I was at Cornell at that time. My flight back east was about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. I thought, what the hell am I going to do in Salt Lake City? Then I thought, the Family History Library. So I called to see if it was open on Saturday morning. And yes, it's open on Saturday morning. And I got there, let's say it opened at 8, I don't know what time it was. I got there about 45 minutes after it opened. It was packed, man. It was packed with Chinese people, Japanese people, Jewish people, Christians, Muslims, everybody tracing their ancestry. And I thought, I was walking around, and this woman stood up and said, I found her, I found her, and started crying. I thought Otis was in the room, and she got the Holy Ghost. And everybody came up and hugged her and stuff, and I thought, wow, man, there's some power to this ancestry tracing, and that's the thing that we want to use to seduce these young black kids, you know, back in the love of learning.
Well, I think we could probably go on with this for quite a while. But if we did, then you wouldn't be able to deliver the surprise that you asked me to remind you about.
Okay.
And here
can
it is.
I do it from right here? Karen, is that all right? I can do it from right here. All right. So yeah, a nice person said that, you know, every September I come and host the Annisfield Wolf Book Awards, and it's a real event, and Otis and Edwina come. So, but what we're doing this time, tonight for the first time, is that we're announcing the winners to you. Ta-da! So you are the first to know the five new winners of the Annisfield Wolf Book Awards, which will be announced after I go to the president's house for dinner. And it is the only juried prize in America for the best books on diversity and excellence, books tackling racism and equity. And I'm the chair of the jury. And as you know, the prize is 82 years old, founded here by Cleveland, administered by the Cleveland Foundation. Here are the winners. For Lifetime Achievement, Isabel Allende. You know her, she's the Chilean-American novelist, burst on the scene with the House of the Spirits in 1982. Since that day, she's been that rare writer with both critical and popular acclaim, having sold 67 million books, translated into 35 languages from the Spanish in which she writes. And we just gave her an honorary degree at Harvard, I think, last year, and I called her in San Francisco to tell her, and she was ecstatic, and she will be here in September. Peter Ho Davies, for his novel, The Fortunes. He sees his innovative book in four sections as, quote, examining the burdens, limitations, and absurdities of Asian stereotypes, unquote. Our juror, Joyce Carol Oates. By the way, the jury is comprised of Joyce Carol Oates, Steven Pinker, my colleague in psychology at Harvard, the great historian Simon Sharma, and Ohio's own Rita Dove, Pulitzer Prize winner, my good buddy. Joyce Carol Oates sees Peter Ho Davies' novel as, quote, a prophetic work with passages of unsurpassing beauty, unquote. Tahimba Jess is the winner for the best book of poetry. The book is called Olio, O-L-I-O. It's an ingenious book from a graduate of the Chicago slam poetry scene, plus a couple of marquee universities, which reclaims black musical performance from the Civil War to World War I. And Jess uses sonnet songs, anecdotes, interviews, and transcripts to craft an historical canvas of poems that wowed your fellow Ohioan, Rita Dove, and indeed, all the rest of us. Karan Mahajan, for his novel, The Association of Small Bombs. We're sharing the fiction prize this year. He took an incident from his boyhood in New Delhi, a car bomb set off in a marketplace, and he transforms that actual event into a tale of violence and its aftermath. Our juror, Simon Sharma, called it, quote, a brilliant explosion of a book, antic, dynamic, and unrelentingly gripping, unquote. And finally, for nonfiction, Margot Lee Shetterly, for book that was made into a movie, Hidden Figures. How many of you saw Hidden Figures? Hidden Figures is subtitled The Untold Story of the Black Women Mathematicians Who Helped Win the Space Race. With her very first book, Shetterly has ridden to the top of the bestseller and box office list. She reclaims another kind of history, that of four black women of NASA whose math skills made the dawn of space travel possible. This is a most riveting book. I mean, who knew? I had no idea. I think I'm a fairly well-educated person. I had no idea those black women were working with John Glenn. You could have knocked me over with a feather. So please, September 7th, Playhouse Square, get a ticket, be there. I'll be hosting, God willing. You'll meet all of these winners for the 2017 Annisfield Wolf Book Award Ceremony. See you then. Thank you for welcoming me. Thank you, Case Western Reserve.
What a spectacular surprise. Thank you for letting us be the first to hear about the Annisfield Wolf Book Award winners. It's an outstanding group of authors. I know many people will be there to celebrate. We feel so lucky that we just had Margot Lee Shetterly here as our Martin Luther King convocation speaker, and she was terrific. So I can tell you it inspired a lot of people on our campus, and we can't wait to have her back in Cleveland along with your other authors. Please join me in thanking Professor Henry Louis Gates for a fascinating lecture, and Professor Peter Knox for facilitating. Thank you.